Hello everyone, welcome to our live webinar for our modular system smart function kit for pressing. Yeah, I'm very happy that we can have this opportunity today to have a live session in order to answer questions from our audience, from internal partners and external interested customers that are eager to learn more about our smart function kit for pressing. My name is Daniel Bauer. I'm business responsible and responsible for product strategy and product vision for the Smart Function Kit. And today I'm not alone.
Yeah, so my name is Thorsten Smetak and I'm responsible for the technique of the Smart Function Kit.
Hey Thorsten.
Hello Daniel. Yeah.
Good to have you here. Really looking forward to the next 40-45 minutes around that we have planned. So we are going to have a deeper look into our system and into our smart function kit for pressing. And in this case, we have the opportunity to really have a demonstrator right here and to show it live there, but also make a deep dive on our cool user interface that we created together with our mechanics that we have and our automation hardware, our drives and controls. So this is pretty cool today.
Yeah, so I'm also very excited. So let's start.
Let's start. Let's deep dive into, and I would say we start at the beginning when we go into the detail about, and we start with the product requirements or the market requirements on the beginning when we started the development. We of course figured out and then we tried to identify what was really the market needs and the requirements. And we said already that we have good components. I think we sell already very cool components from the mechanical side, but there was a very strong tendency to get more systems and solutions to really bring a sophisticated overall mechanical modular system. So that's what we have here and what we created. So there was a requirement for that, but also a requirement to save significant engineering time. And last but not least, we had a strong tendency towards fast and easy commissioning for products and for systems. So these were all topics that we considered when we created our smart function kit.
Exactly. Yeah.
So, and what are our answers to that? The answers that we gave to those requirements were easy product selection. So we can very easily have a choice between pre-selected mechanical, electrical components and the added software, which we created. And this is displayed in several kits with a force range from 2 up to 30 kilonewton. Another feature that we can provide with our system is the factor zero programs. So you don't have to have dedicated knowledge in programming of a PLC. So no coding experience in that case necessary. You have a very simple logical configuration of your joining and pressing process with our user interface. And of course, in addition to that, evaluation elements, if parts were good or not good, we will have a look on that later. And we have our browser-based user interface, which can be used in various devices. And this is pretty cool. And besides that, we have the overall wording and the value contribution of plug and produce, meaning that you get every part and every component which belongs to this kit in a single package delivered from Bosch Rexroth from one hand, including the pre-installed software on the drive and on the PR21.
Yeah.
So this is something that, in our opinion, is pretty cool. And but Thorsten, I was wondering what kind of applications we can solve with our or we can target with our system.
Yeah. So now then let's have a look at the application the smart function kit is used in. So first of all, we have the common applications of press fitting and pressing. So the standard kind of applications, but especially in the area of pressing in some kind of bearings, this is where you can use the product, especially also for the manufacturing of electrical motors. So in the e-mobility, you definitely need to have that product. Another application or use case is the manufacturing of battery cells, and also, so not only the manufacturing, but also for test units, so testing battery cells is a use case, and next, of course, all kind of electronic manufacturing, so manufacturing of electronic boards, of electronic contacts, plugs. And there you are coming to the applications of crimping and clipping. So we've got a wide variety of applications where the smart function kit can be used or is used already. And I think so it should be a really interesting product for every manufacturer and machine builder.
Absolutely. So I think we can jump over to our system architecture.
Yeah, so the system architecture. So the technique behind the smart function kit. First of all, we've got the electromechanical cylinder, the EMC cylinder. So this is the main mechanical part. It's the actuator you can see here in our demonstration unit. It's mounted here on top of the unit. And there it's driven by an servo motor. You can see it here slightly. So it's mounted through an belt side drive. And this servo motor is the new MS2M. So this is the newest motor generation of Bosch Rexroth, with an absolute encoder and also with a holding brake for all the kind of vertical applications. So then next we've got the force sensor.
Mm-hmm.
So the force sensor is mounted here in front of the piston rod. So it's directly mounted to the piston rod, also to make it very easy to integrate the sensor in your application. So next, what is very important is the complete automation hardware. So in our demonstration unit, we've got this in the cabinet below. So what's included in the kit is the servo drive, so with an integrated PLC, and also with safety functionality. And besides that, we've got this small industrial PC, the PR21. And the PR21, this is the brain of the system. So there's the web server running, providing the web interface.
And our algorithm, right?
There are also running the complete software, the algorithm, and you've got also the database for the process
mm-hmm.
data there. So this is what it makes in a smart function kit, actually. There also we provide additional interfaces like OPC-UA or an HTTP interface. Future-proof interfaces to connect everything to your IT systems.
That's another value contribution, probably very important for customers, and I think we will jump to that point a bit later in detail,
yeah.
But nevertheless, open interfaces are very important for us, and we're a key driver in developing this product. So being future-proof with our interfaces is something that matters a lot to us, and I think we will have a look on that later, but very interesting for the first shot, but I would say it's more interesting that we now really have a look on the system and jump into our interface.
Yeah, so I'm happy to show you the user interface. So for that,
maybe beforehand we can say something about the commissioning, because currently we are in the situation that the system is already running.
Yeah.
So we cannot display the process of commissioning due to time limitations. It takes only 10 to 15 minutes, probably pretty quick, but maybe you can lose a couple of words to the commissioning beforehand.
Yeah, so the complete commissioning process is user guided through a wizard, user wizard. So you have a few steps you have to click through. And but one of these steps is copying the software on the servo drive, and this takes about 10 minutes.
Mm-hmm.
And it's really boring to watch just the status bar moving on for 10 minutes, so we skip that. So we've got already the commission system here, and we will have a look at the complete user interface and what we can do then after these first commissioning steps.
Great.
So. Okay. I'm connected here now through a network with the system. I'm opened up a web browser here. So this is Firefox, but you can use Google Chrome or any modern browser. And now I'm typing in the IP address of the system to open up the web interface. So and now you can see here the dashboard. So this is the complete overview of the machine and the process which is running. So this is the main point where the operator of the machine can see if the process is running good or if is, there's any problem with the machine.
Mm-hmm.
So we've got here on the left, we've got a production statistic where you can see how many pieces already have been produced.
Mm-hmm.
You've got here the sequence which is running, and you've got also here some actual status and values of the machine, so
mm-hmm.
position and force and velocity and so on. Mm-hmm. So this is the main area for the operator, and he can change the loaded program, and he can also start a process.
Mm-hmm. So. And we just saw right away pretty quickly changed language, so
yeah.
This is also something which is easy. I mean, we had it in German just beforehand, but now switched to English, and now we can see it the process.
Yeah, so I started it once, and you have seen the demonstrator is running, so I can just start it once again. I'm switching here to another cool feature, the live preview of the force displacement curve. So if you now start it once again, you can see how the demonstrator unit moves. It is pressing down to a spring here and building up a force, and you can see here in this graph the live preview of the force that is applied to the spring.
Mm-hmm.
So yeah, this is the main entry point of the system.
Okay.
Everything on one glance. So you have have it on a tablet on your machine, and you can have a look at it and see if the process is running or if there are any mm-hmm. problems.
And then you mentioned beforehand this was the operator view,
yeah.
And I can imagine there's something different here when you are an SPS programmer, or when you are the one who's engineering a process. Yeah. I'm just figuring out, or I'm realizing that we have the first questions. What language options are there? It's at the moment we just have the German and the English version currently available, but this is something which is actually pretty easy to realize, right? So Torsten, maybe you can say a couple of words to
yeah,
language
so,
versions.
Yeah, so at the moment we've got German and English supported languages, so you can switch between these languages here. You see it's English and German, behind the scenes there's a language file. And if you add another languages there, that's not a big deal. So mm-hmm. should be easy task. So we just have to know what languages have to be supported.
Yes.
Yeah.
Well, but nevertheless, from the technical point of view, very easy to realize.
Yeah. We just need somebody translating it. Yeah.
Exactly. Well, but no problem.
Depending on the language, of course. Yeah. Okay. So now we've got here the operator view.
Yeah.
You already mentioned it. And the operator is only able to see everything and start the process or stop it, but he can't change the program or make a new program or change any parameters.
Mm-hmm.
So this is locked behind, so you have to log in to be able to do so. So this is now the mode you are using after logging, normally if you're a PLC programmer or a process expert, and then you've got here more options where you can interact with the system. So one option I want to show you today, which is I think a real cool thing, and you really will be impressed by it, is how to create a new program. Because I will promise you, it only takes a minute or two, and you will have a new program running on the system. So for that, we are starting here in the program overview. There we've got listed all programs available at the moment.
Mm-hmm.
So these programs are now stored in the PLC,
mm-hmm.
in the drive. And we've got also here some preview on the right side where you can see which steps the program is built off, and also a preview of the parameters running.
Mm-hmm.
And now we are pressing here the add button and creating a new program.
Mm-hmm.
So we start with giving it a name, so just calling it webinar for the moment. So now here on the left side you've got a library. And in this library, you've got predefined building blocks. So
mm-hmm.
these building blocks represent steps you normally have in a joining application.
Mm-hmm.
So you've got, for example, the initial position, so where to start the process, position building block.
Mm-hmm.
So this is moving to a defined position, and
mm-hmm.
also, for example, join to force.
Sorry for interrupting you, Torsten, for a second. We have a couple of questions in our chats, and I would just ask you, I mean, we can we can postpone one of them. For example, if we can use inputs to choose different programs, we will come to that point regarding inputs later, I think, mm-hmm. in our interfaces segment, right?
Yeah.
So please be a bit patient. We will answer and we will come back to you later on. And how many programs can be stored? I mean, we can already say in advance because this question would have come probably later anyways.
Yeah. So it's 99 programs that can be stored. Yeah. So
exactly.
That's the limit at the moment. Yeah.
So we will come to. We will not forget you in case that we might miss one or two questions right away. But we saw with the inputs the question, we will come back to you later. So sorry for interrupting, Torsten. We can just jump into again to create such of the one of the programs.
Yeah. So now creating a program is as easy as just dragging the building blocks in the right order you need for your process. So we're starting here with an initial position block, defining it at start position 0 millimeters, and we want to get there if we aren't there already. Really fast. And next I would say is to have an intermediate position. So this would be to get fast forward to the part you want to press or to join. So we define it here for about 80 millimeters, for mm-hmm. example. And there we define also a higher velocity.
Mm-hmm. What happens if I exceed now one of those values? Is there any mechanical limitation if I create some programs like that?
Yeah, so the complete capabilities of the system, so what is limited by the mechanics, is stored in the software.
Okay.
And you've got here for all parameters the validation, mm-hmm. Which checks if the value is capable or if you can use it. So here, for example, now if I try to move with 1,000 millimeters per second, which is quite quite fast, it immediately states me, okay, no, you have to be below 320, for example, for this system.
And this is based on our sizing and the configuration of the initial system in the engineering process.
Yeah. So and so it's nearly impossible to damage it at that point because mm-hmm. You're immediately informed if you type in anything that doesn't make any sense.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so now we've got our fast forward position.
Mm-hmm.
Now let's have the join to force. Mm-hmm. This is more or less the main part of a joining system.
So absolutely,
we go for 600 newtons here for the demonstration unit.
Also, you can add here 6,000 probably, and then we see another failure coming up.
Or 6,000 would be possible.
6,000 makes 60,000 or something.
So, but 60,000, there, then we've got already the message here. Okay, so for the pressing, we reduce the velocity, so we don't want to damage the part and also the spring here in the demonstration unit, we don't want to damage it. And just go for 10 millimeters per second for here now.
Mm-hmm.
So maybe now we add another building block here, a short delay, half a second, for example. And then to close the loop, we're going back to our initial position. We want to do that really fast because cycle time matters.
Mm-hmm.
And with that, our program is finished. It's an easy, but I think it's a representative program for joining. And we hit save. So, and after the program has been saved, we can go back to the dashboard. We can choose our new created program here.
Mm-hmm.
We already see the production statistic updated, so no parts yet produced.
Mm-hmm.
And we can hit start, and the system is starting.
Mm-hmm.
And you see how the steps are going through.
We have another question in the chat. It's an absolute or a relative positioning? Good question. We can talk about later when we talk about the detailed programming once again, but you can say already a few words to that.
Yeah, so you have the choice. You can have absolute or relative positions. So it depends on your application what you need.
Yeah. But we can add here in the program there's a short.
I can show you really quickly. If you go back to editing this program we created, we can change, for example, the position building block here and check mark the relative positioning, and then it would be going for 80 millimeters.
And we can manually, when we go into an installation or when we manually want to move, we can also do this by going here to or going out of the program and showing the manual movement, right?
Yeah. So you can have here some kind of if you want to set up the system, manual moving of the system, or you can also define here, for example, stepping 10 millimeters for every press and all kind of that stuff to make it more easy for you commissioning the system. So now we go back here to zero. Mm-hmm.
Okay, so what we did now see how to create a program. This was pretty fast. So I think less than a minute, and we created a joining pressing program. That's pretty cool and pretty awesome. So, but of course, we at the moment just see in the dashboard. I mean, one part was good because I mean there was no reference criteria if a part was good or bad. So how is this going? How can we evaluate if a part was good or bad?
Yeah. So for now, we only have created the program, but no quality criteria. To do so, we go here to the reference curve sections, and there we can now record reference curves.
Mm-hmm.
So this would be curves for reference parts. So normally, if you start with a process with a new machine, you're building, let's say, 10 parts
mm-hmm.
for starting, and then you're examining the parts and looking if they are good or not good, and that's what you can do here. So you can record several parts or curves. You can also rename them and give them an ID or a serial number or anything.
Mm-hmm.
And with that set of curves, you can then define the quality criteria.
And we can also mirror this and then import and export either programs or reference curves, right?
Yeah, so you can all you're doing here, you can save and then import it in another machine so that you have the possibility to have one prototype machine, and you do all the parameterization, all the programming there, and then just copying it to several other serial machines, making the engineering process
only
much
once.
Faster.
Yeah, well, once, you just install it on your prototype and then mirror this to I don't know how many systems you want to install, and that's pretty cool, I think.
Yeah. Okay.
So we see the reference curve now that we created. So I think you made now two. You can say this is a good one, this is a bad part, so you can evaluate this here right away. It's a good or bad reference.
Yeah. And you can also hide curves here. So I'm hiding now the second one here. So we're just starting for the easiness with one curve
one,
here.
Yeah.
And now in the next step here, we now can define the quality criteria. So this is as easy as making some kind of PowerPoint.
Okay, cool.
So you just press in here, add validation element, and now you can just click in here and draw, let's say, a simple window, elaboration window, to be able to make the quality check. And you get a live feedback here already. So you see here the red line indicates that, okay, with that settings, this kind of curve would be a part that is not okay, because we've got here the intersection, and so we are changing this here now also with some few clicks.
Mm-hmm.
And so now this window is set to that the curve is going into the window but not going outside of it.
Mm-hmm. Can we just make a quick stop for a couple of questions from the audience? Is it possible to attach more load cells or external linear encoders? In case this is in this case, how much?
So at the moment, it's only possible to have the included linear encoder and also only one load cell. So, but you can use a user specified or an individual load cells. You don't have to use the one that is delivered with the system. So you can use the system with the standard load cell, or without any load cell, but then with reduced accuracy, or with any kind of compatible load cell you want to use.
Can we interrupt the process during operation with external signals? And I think this has been already in the Bible with the blocks already there, that we can give a trigger signal into our process, right?
Yeah, so there you can use these inputs, these digital inputs, as trigger signals for the process control. So defining some steps to run with when the signal comes and so on, but you can also have the signals triggering main features of the system, so maybe triggering the start of the process or stopping it, resetting any errors, tearing the force sensor, and all these kind of main features, I would say.
And this is always, I mean, when we come to that point, interfaces and the interaction with other systems a bit later on, but this is also when we communicate then with a higher laying PLC, right? So then we very often have some signals or triggers.
Yes, then you have field bus signals, but you can also use only simple digital signals, digital inputs, and there's also a bunch of functionalities you can trigger with that.
So another question, can a force be held in delay step for a longer time, so plus 60 seconds, examples by activating the motor brake?
So the force is held, yeah, that is possible, but the motor brake is not engaged at that moment. So the motor itself has to be able to hold the force. So for that kind of applications, we definitely have to make a calculation in beforehand to be able to evaluate if it is possible with that size of smart function kit to do that kind of force for that time.
Can we use it to exert traction efforts? So can you specify it a bit more?
Yeah, so I'm not understanding that the first point. So maybe, could you please go in more detail for that question, and we will then go back.
Go again and continue with our evaluation criteria. So we set here the window, meaning that the force has to go through it, and this is a criteria we give. But you show another evaluation criteria.
So we are just adding here another, just a simple envelope or threshold here to make sure that here in the beginning of the joining process that there aren't any problems, any misalignment that would be causing a force peak here. And with that element, we could detect that and define that for not okay part. So with that elements defined, we go back to our dashboard. And I'm switching here to the live preview, and we are starting the process once again. So the system is running, applying these 600 newtons of force, and we immediately see here now the elevation elements, and everything is green here. This part is actually produces a okay part.
Just quickly jump into, I mean, pulling force instead of pressing force. Yes, we have the ability with, over the sensor to measure a pulling force also. Yeah. Can you say a couple of words to that?
Yeah, so the whole system is capable of recording pulling forces as it is as pushing forces. So it depends a little bit on the sensor you're using. The standard sensor is mainly meant to be used for pushing forces, and it can only handle or it can only record 10% of the pushing force as a pulling force. So this is mainly meant to be to examine the process step when you go back from your tool, and to see if there is any misalignment or anything happened there in the process, to see if there is any kind of peak and to stop the system. If you really want to use bigger pulling forces, then there would have to be used another sensor.
But this is possible. You can order a system with or without sensor, then use your own. I think we have another question. The topic with the PLCs and the parameters coming from a PLC is something we can discuss a bit later on. I'll just go through quickly, but I think we should go on the first. We said now we have here a set of parameters. We have a quality check. So what happens now? Can we just have a look if I change something, if I have another workpiece, what happens to my system?
Yeah, so what we can do is now, I've got here another spring. So this spring is a little bit longer than the initial one we've got in here. So If we're now changing spring, so we're putting in the wrong part, to say, we should immediately see that the evaluation is here then not okay part, and that the system gives us a message about that. So I'm changing this one now quickly.
Maybe I can answer already one question. Yes, you can set a limit of value of kilonewtons in a process. Yeah, you can. And are we capable of having STO compliant SFK? So safe torque off is a function that is already displayed as a safety function in the system.
Yeah, STO is supported by as a standard functionality. Yeah, so this is also what we've got here now for the demonstration unit.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so let's have a look.
So I now changed the spring, and we are starting the process once again. Let the system run. It's now pressing on the other spring here, on the wrong spring, to say. And now see, as it is building up the 600 Newton force. And we've got our quality evaluation elements, and we see at the first glance that this part is not okay, so it is not the result we expected. The force here went up earlier. That's because the spring is higher.
Mm-hmm.
So that's how easy it is to have the quality assurance for your production parts. Yeah.
That's pretty cool, but those data, the process data, is probably the very valuable information for the PLC programmer, the one who creates the joining process, right, and the program. So what can we do with this data?
Yeah, so the data is stored in an internal database, but we've got interfaces to access them. So first we take a look at the database here. So we can go here, click on that icon, and then we are in the database where we have a list of all the parts we produced with a lot of main information and unique ID and timestamp and the result of the process. And we've got also all the data behind, so the curve, the program, the evaluation, all data is stored. And what is important, we've got also here complete, you can see all the changes that have been made. So this is with the right spring, this was before was with the wrong spring, and this is even before we defined any quality elements. So the system is remembering all the changes, and you can access all the data here. Moreover, you can export single data sets, but you can also export a complete data, all the values
all the
of one
parameter sets and all the reference curves. And which format is this when we export them?
It's JSON.
That's a JSON format.
So
okay.
It's a very common format, and there are a lot of converters for it. You can open it in Excel or other programs you want to use to investigate then the process data more. Yeah, so this is accessing it manually here.
So we talked a lot about interfaces. Now I think this is something which probably is also interesting for our audience. So how can I integrate now my system or the smart function kit for pressing in machine infrastructure at a customer? What options do I have here?
Yeah. So first the first option you've got is to use a field bus interface. Mm-hmm. So if you go here in the system settings to show this also once, we can go here in the system, and there you can set the field bus communication profile you want to use.
Mm-hmm.
So we support here Cercos, EtherCAT, Profinet, and Ethernet IP as field bus interfaces. And for these individual field buses, we also supply building blocks, predefined building blocks you can use in the overlying PLC. You can import it there, and that makes it very easy to communicate with the system, to command the system. Mm-hmm. So with that, you can then change the program, you can start or stop the system, you get access to the process result, to live data as a position and force, which is at the moment. So this opens up a lot of opportunities or possibilities to command the smart function kit. So yeah, that's for the, I would say, standard interface, field bus interface, but we've got also OPC UA, and the HTTP interface, which is more meant to be used with overlying IT systems, manufacturing execution systems, to be able to access all the information that is stored in the database or the process information, to be able to use that for any kind of overlying quality check or quality system.
If we talk about overlaying systems, the PLCs, of course, standard-wise, connected over field buses, and then we have OPC UA for MES systems. And I think this is what makes our system pretty future-proof and pretty cool when it comes to open interfaces in different directions. So I think this is something which also is interesting for us. So we would do here another voting questions. Question to the audience. It's a multiple choice question, and we want to ask you, what interfaces are relevant for you? And this is for us also important to see if we are on the right track and if there are any or some let's say interfaces which are not in the future were not available here. But I think the system has already all of the relevant ones in place, and that's why. Good to know what we have here. So I'll give you another seconds, 5 seconds to answer this question. Okay, so very interesting. There's a very strong tendency towards Ethernet IP.
Yeah.
We can imagine that. We have that's around 70% almost. Then we have a 44% Profinet. 36% EtherCAT. I would say those are the three main important interfaces. And then, yes, we can cope all that. We can cope with their requirements. Okay. So Thorsten, I would say first of all, thanks. Thanks a lot for your presentation, for the deep dive into the system. I think it was very interesting for the moment, but I think. It is also now interesting for us to give you, or it's good for us and that we can give you more chances now, more possibilities to ask some questions here in the audience, and we try to answer them. And then we will have some additional information later on. But so we have here from one colleague, Watson Youngman, if the possible set a load limit values per seconds, okay? Can we set load limit values per
second? Not per second. So we can set load limit values, to protect the machine, for example, but not per second. So this is not possible. But would be nice to hear what kind of application this would be or what it meant to be.
So by the way, information for you, we have, as we said, external, internal, service partners here. So if there's any requirement, don't hesitate to contact your business partners from Bosch Rexroth. That's anyways, and of course, if we get the use cases and have a look on that, we can maybe just give you feedback on that too. So maybe Thorsten, some additional questions maybe before the audience raises them. We can change IP addresses, for example, on the system too pretty easily, right?
Yeah, this is possible for sure. So as you're used to be used, so you can go here to the system section, and there you can change the IP address range of the system to be able to use it in your network. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
So we've got a lot additional questions now here.
In which range, minimum, maximum kilonewton, is the kit available? So maybe we can jump over to a slide here and give you a short overview of that. Thorsten, maybe you can guide us through the product configuration here.
Yeah, so at the moment the product, we have 6 different sizes of the smart function kit.
Mm-hmm.
So this is 2 kilonewtons up to 30 kilonewtons we are providing. For these 6 sizes, then you can configure in more detail the system with the stroke you need or what kind of motor mounting, should it be in line or parallel, and do you need the force sensor, or do you use your own, what cable lengths do you need, and so on. But it's very easy and straightforward to configure it. It's only 5 steps, and everything else is then automatically configured to make sense or to be able to have this solid unions, for example.
Okay, so we have, I think, a lot of questions now coming up. I'm sorry if we cannot manage to answer all of them, but just go through that. What about the alarm management? If there any error during the process, how can you get information?
So yeah, you get the information with the dashboard, so you see it there, mm-hmm. noted there. And as I mentioned, we've got these HTTP interface, so you can easily use, for example, Node-RED or any kind of other overlying IT to access this kind of information and to maybe display it elsewhere or to use it to display it on your smartphone. Or,
mm-hmm.
So it shouldn't be any problem for a software engineer. So because the system is quite open, so you've got all these access possibilities.
So another question, if it's possible to save the log file automatically in the SAP system.
No, so there's not a predefined interface for SAP. I'm not sure if this would be possible because I think SAP system is, it depends on the business you are or how this organized and so that's not provided.
So we have a comment regarding, yes, we will come to the point of configuration and how is it done in our tool chain right away. So yeah, give us a minute and then we answer that. So maybe we can answer another question from the audience. How do we receive the complete project to do the commissioning software kit? So you get everything in one package. So enter our sizing and our configuration tools, and we come to that point in a minute. And then you, at the end, when you get your CAD files and drawings, and you order via our eShop, you will then get a delivery with all the components and the pre-installed software in one package.
It's a complete package. All the cables are included, the automation hardware. So you just have to take it then and place it in your machine frame. Place the components into your cabinet and you can start right away.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so I think now we should go to exactly to the point of how do we get to the right smart function kit here.
Well, I think it was mentioned before, we have a sophisticated tool chain from Bosch Rexroth, and when you want to enter and when you want to configure and size your product corresponding to your use case and to the process you want to display it, and you have our tools available on for your help. And this tool for sizing is called Lint Select. We will share the link how to enter this. But nevertheless, anyway, you can contact our Bosch Rexroth external sales partners, which might support you in that. And if you enter Lint Select, you can go through. You enter your process parameters. Maybe we show. What happens when you enter our system? This is the landing page from Lint Select. And if you are on the landing page, you just enter the segment actuators here, and then you can directly come to the next page where you jump into the process and design your process accordingly.
Yeah, at the end of Lint Select, you get the complete configuration that fits exactly to your application. And you can jump right away to the CAD file configurator and start your construction of your machine. Yeah.
So I see there's another question. How do you set a constant force to a specified stroke?
I'm not sure if I get that question right. So maybe we have to talk about that later in more detail. I'm not sure what is the intention of that.
Okay, maybe we can specify this a little more. But in the meantime, if there are any more questions, then we're happy to answer. But before we finish, just another quick information: how you can contact us. You can go to our country-wise specific Bosch Rexroth homepages. In order to enter the product segment for the smart function kit, and there also on the homepage you can get direct links to the mentioned tools like Lint Select, and then You can just configure your own smart function kit for pressing. So I would say we're close to the end, Thorsten. It was a lot of fun. Thanks for being here.
Yeah.
It was a pleasure to show our great modular system. It was fun. I hope you had fun too.
Yeah, I had really fun, and I hope you also enjoyed it. Yeah.
So I think this format was well perceived from you all in the line, and yeah, hopefully we can do a similar webinar in the future again. Maybe then with a bit more detailed information on any specific questions regarding the software or any technical aspects. But I think for the beginning, to give an overall big picture of the system, this webinar was aimed for, and hopefully it was good for you too. You enjoyed this webinar, and hope to get a feedback from you, and get some contacts, and get questions from you in the future.